Genesis chapter 6. In this chapter, the Lord sees the wickedness of humans and decides to wipe out everyone with a flood, but Noah finds favor in God's eyes. Now, let me give you the expanded summary before giving some minor points and then the major points of this chapter. The chapter begins by talking about the sons of God who see that the daughters of humans are beautiful and they chose to marry any of those they wanted. Now we'll talk about who these sons of God are in a bit, but let's move on with the story. In response, the Lord says he's going to limit human years to 120. Now it also mentions the Nephilim were on the earth in those days and also afterward. So this seems to imply that the Nephilim are no longer around at the time the author is writing this book, who is traditionally understood to be Moses. It says the Nephilim were on the earth in those days and also afterward, implying, but they're no longer around now. When the sons of God went to the daughters of humans and had children by them, they were the heroes of old, men of renown. So these Nephilim are very special human beings. Later in the Bible, in the book of Numbers, the Nephilim are described as giants, the giants who are living in the land, descendants of Anak. And so the Israelites were afraid of them because they were so big in stature. So this is what we know about the Nephilim, only from a couple passages in the Bible. Some people think that the Nephilim are the offspring of the sons of God and the daughters of humans, but the text doesn't make that explicit. It doesn't say that here. It just says they were around at that time when the sons of God went to the daughters of humans. So the Lord is going to limit human years to 120. We'll talk about what that may mean also. Now the Lord saw that human wickedness was great, and he was sorry that he had made humans on the earth, and it grieved him to his heart. So he decides to destroy all human beings along with animals and birds, but Noah finds favor in God's sight. And it describes Noah as walking with God, something we saw with Enoch. Noah also walked with God. Now, while there seems to be some transgression with the sons of God marrying humans, the particular sin highlighted is violence. It says the earth was corrupt and filled with violence. Verse 11, Genesis 6:11. So, in response, God shares his plan with Noah, what he's going to do, how he's going to destroy all life. And he instructs Noah to build an ark of cypress or gopher wood. The NIV gives a footnote here that says the Hebrew word is uncertain what it actually means, what type of wood. But we know it was a wood that is going to save the human race. Now, the Lord's instructions for building this wooden vessel included its dimensions, 300 cubits long, which would be about 450 feet in length. So think of an American football field, one and a half of those in length. And then its width would be about 75 feet, 50 cubits. 75 feet, so about half of an American football field would be the width of this vessel, and then it would be about 45 feet high. So it would also have three decks, a roof, and God even told Noah how big that space should be underneath the roof, how big the opening should be, and how he should place a door in this ark. Although everything would be destroyed, God promised Noah, "I will establish my covenant with you. You shall come into the ship, your sons, your wife, and your sons' wives with you. Of every living thing of all flesh, you shall bring two of every sort into the ship to keep them alive with you. They shall be male and female." And Noah did everything just as God commanded him. And that's the last sentence of this chapter. Noah was fully obedient to the Lord's instructions. Okay, so minor points. Who are the sons of God who married the daughters of men? Some think this is a reference to descendants of Seth. Remember, there's this godly line, the line of Seth, and a wicked line or unrighteous line, the line of Cain. So some think this is the sons of God are sons of Seth who married daughters of Cain, because we have that contrast in the previous chapter, as we saw, well, the middle of chapter 4 into chapter 5, the contrast between these two lines. The sons of God, however, that phrase is used for angels in the book of Job. Also, the ancient Jewish book 1 Enoch, written as early as the 1st century BC, narrates the story of angels cohabitating with human females. And it says that their offspring were giants. And then it even says where evil spirits come from comes from the bodies of these giants. So these are certainly strange ideas, certainly very, very unusual. 2 Peter and Jude also talk about angels who transgressed their boundaries, but it doesn't specify what the transgression was, but angels sinned. Angels trespassed the boundary that they should have stayed within, and thus we have fallen angels. So this is a very intriguing idea. How could this be possible? Fallen angels with human females. A lot of questions around that, but this is not the main point of this passage. We have a problem in this area, sons of God, but it's not really giving us a lot of details. So let's move on to another, what I think is minor point, the 120 years. God says that their days will be 120 years. So this could mean one of two things, 120 more years until the flood, or the human lifespan would now be limited to somewhere around 120 years. A couple ideas there, we're not certain. Third question, how can the Nephilim in Genesis 6:4 be the same as the Nephilim in Numbers 13:33? If everyone is wiped out in the flood, wouldn't that mean the Nephilim are destroyed as well? I mean, only Noah and his family are saved. So how can the Nephilim, who were on the earth in those days, be on the earth after the flood? How is that possible? Some believe this question shows that the reference in Numbers 13 should not be taken literally. That Numbers 13 is speaking more metaphorically, they're like the Nephilim, or it's symbolic in some way of these strange creatures, or strange humans, I should say, who were on the earth in those days. Others think that this shows the flood was not global, that the flood was regional, and so other people were living in other places and did survive. And we'll talk more about that as we go into the flood story. All right, so those are three what I think are minor points, because the text doesn't give us much detail. The major points, I believe, are these. Number one, violence spreads and it is a major problem in God's eyes. God was deeply troubled. It grieved him to his heart, and he decided to destroy everything because of human corruption and violence. Notice how violence has spread from Cain killing Abel. And then we have his great-great-great-grandson, Lamech, killing a young man for wounding him in Genesis 4. And now we have violence that has filled the earth. So there's a spread going on throughout the earth of people hurting each other, people killing each other. Starts with Cain and then spreads throughout the earth. Now we may think we're much more moral and advanced than these people who lived way back then, but remember, we're the beneficiaries of law and order. So what would we be like without laws, police, prisons, surveillance cameras? How moral would we be? How would we really act? You have to take this way back to the beginning of civilization. when all those things weren't in place and the technology wasn't there. So how would we act if there weren't consequences, if we don't have a structure of law and order? Number two, another main point here is God has feelings. The text says that God was emotionally distraught. It grieved him to his heart, or he was deeply troubled. When he looked at humans and saw how they were living, this was not how he wanted them to live. And he is disturbed at what he's seeing. This is really, really bothering him. Throughout the Bible, God expresses intense emotions. And in the New Testament, we see Jesus weeping at Lazarus's tomb. So the Bible depicts God with emotions, not someone who doesn't feel, but someone who feels intensely and cares about how we live. Humans were hurting each other. Humans were killing each other. And God is upset at what they are doing. Number three, God is just. God judges the wicked and saves the righteous. This is a major point. He did not destroy Noah and his family. Noah was walking with him. Noah was righteous in God's eyes, and Noah was saved. He wasn't wiped away in the flood. God saved Noah and his family because God is just. Number four, God makes covenants with humans. A covenant is a solemn promise. God told Noah, "I will establish my covenant with you." This is the first time the word covenant is used in the Bible. It's in Genesis 6:18, and it will become a major theme. Christians even divide the entire Bible into two sections based on this theme, the Old Testament or the Old Covenant and the New Testament or the New Covenant. So covenant is a major theme. God wants to make these promises with human beings. He is a covenant-making, a promise-making God, and this is how he relates with us. He gives us his word, he gives us his promise, and then we trust that promise. So this is the basis of our relationship with God, these covenants that he's making with us. And number five, God is our Savior. God designs and accomplishes our salvation. Judgment and salvation belong to God. He was looking for someone to accomplish his plan of salvation through, and he found Noah. He also instructed Noah to build a vessel that would save the human race. And these instructions included details, the size, the dimensions, the number of levels or decks, the roof, the opening underneath the roof, the door, what it should be made out of, the type of material. These were all ideas God had. This was God's plan of salvation. He's going to save the human race through this vessel. So God is our Savior. It was his idea, not Noah's. He's given the instructions to Noah, and Noah's obeying, but the heart of God is to save the human race. And this is our fifth main point in this story.